Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Bounce Back Thursdays. Keeping in line with our ongoing Bouncing Back and Going Beyond 2020 campaign, this is a weekly talk aimed at empowering you with the information you need in helping your business bounce back from the challenges of the COVID-19 pandemic. Now, the topic for this month is money recovery. At the beginning of this month, we covered the topic of money recovery in relation to check bounce cases. If you missed that topic, you can find the link to that video in the description. If you're watching this video on YouTube, you can find the link to that video here. Now, if you're facing any trouble with money recovery, there is a Google form in the description. Enter your contact details over there. At the end of the month, we're going to select a few people and help them send legal notices to the concerned parties completely free of cost. So make sure you enter your contact details. Now, having said that, let's move on to the topic for this week, which is money recovery through civil suits. Joining me today is subject matter expert and manager of growth and strategy here at Vakil Search, Mr. Antim Amlan. Welcome, Antim.
Hi, Ranaya. Pleasure to be here.
Thank you, Antim. Great to see you. So before we get started on today's topic, which is money recovery through civil suit, I think it's best to cover what are the different types of money recovery options here in India.
Yeah, Rana, about that question, I think it's very important for any aggrieved person. Most importantly, the creditors who are looking forward to recover their money. All right. So the Indian laws are pretty diverse in nature when it comes to debt recovery procedures. Okay. There are extensive collection of laws that can help a creditor depending on the nature of the facts and the situation and circumstances of the case. Right. Okay. So as an advocate, what I can suggest a person or a creditor to do at the very first instance is to basically send a legal notice through a registered advocate, okay, yeah, claiming the amount of money, stating the reasons for the repercussions of non-payment and the reasons, if any.
Right.
Okay. So one, if the money is still unpaid after the legal notice, then you can perhaps proceed to the courts or the appropriate forums that are there.
Okay.
Okay. So starting with criminal law, okay, yeah, there are sections in the IPC and under the Negotiable Instruments Act, as we popularly call it, check bounce cases. Section 138 and 141 of the Negotiable Instruments Act deal with the check bounce cases.
Okay.
Okay. Again, the important sections in IPC are section 403, which is dishonest misappropriation of property, section 405, which is criminal breach of trust, and then other sections such as 415 for cheating, which are important when we see a criminal case for recovering your money.
Right.
And importantly, the criminal cases are originated from the FIR. Okay.
Okay.
Under civil law, there are two different types of proceedings. The first one are the ordinary civil suit, or also called as money suit. Okay. And the second one type is basically summary suits,
which we'll be covering later on. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that's correct. Yeah. And in the most recent and most effective form of recovering your money are basically insolvency proceedings. But okay, insolvency proceedings are generally initiated against body corporates or against corporates, which are basically public limited companies, private limited companies, or LLPs. Okay, okay. As per this new latest enactment, which is Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016.
Okay. Right. Yeah.
However, the limit to file an insolvency proceeding under IBC has been revised to 1 crore from the existing 1 lakh during this pandemic, that is from 24th March 2020.
Okay.
All right. So these are the most popular forms of recovering money that one can avail.
All right. So thank you for briefly explaining all of that. So I think it's time we get into the crux of the main topic of our discussion, which is money recovery through civil suit. So can you take us through that?
Yeah, sure, Anay. So importantly, under civil law, there are two different procedures, as I just explained.
Yeah.
We'll first deal with ordinary suits, or as we call it, money suit. Then we'll come back to summary suits, right? So money suits are initiated through what we call as plaint. Okay. Plaints are basically legal documents containing the plaintiff's claim with all the relevant details. Okay. Such as the precise amount in possession of the defendant and or a reasonable estimate of what you cannot estimate, okay, or what of what you cannot give a precise amount.
Right.
So the money suits are defined under Rule 2 and Order 7 of CPC. The plaint, however, is filed under Section 26 and Order 4 of the CPC.
Okay.
Okay. Just the fact that the plaint must comply with the rules and procedural formalities given under Order 6 and Order 7.
Okay.
Yeah. Let's ask what are the steps involved in a particular money suit.
Hmm.
All right. So money suits are usually time consuming. The reason is the defendant is given ample amount of time to respond back. Okay. So it always starts with the institution of the suits. Okay, once I file a plaint as per the CPC, then it goes to the court and the suit is instituted after the court considers it.
Okay.
Second step is the appearance of party. Both the plaintiff and the defendant have to appear before the court. The third step is the written statement by the defendant. Okay. And the time period given to a defendant for filing written statement is 30 days. Okay. Okay. Fourth step is framing of issues. Issues are the question on which the judgment is delivered. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Fifth step is the trial evidence. Sixth step are the final arguments provided by both parties as to why their case is more fair. And the seventh step is the decree. So decree is basically the final judgment of the court, which eventually, gives the verdict whether the plaintiff has, the defendant has to pay the money to the plaintiff or not. Okay. And then a part or a step that follows the decree is basically execution of the decree when the real recovery of the money or the defendant really pays to the plaintiff. So this is what, or this is how the ordinary suits under CPC work.
Got it.
Now moving on to, all right. So, it's very easy to understand, by the way, summary suits are what what the name suggests, which is basically summary in nature. The procedures are summary or give you a faster outcome.
Okay.
Basically to the aggrieved person, right?
Hmm.
So summary suits again are referred and are covered under Order 37 of the Civil Procedure Code.
Okay.
It can be initiated against the defaulter, but unlike the civil ordinary suits or money suits, the time given to the defendant is merely 10 days. And if the defendant fails to make the appearance before the court within 10 days, then the verdict is given against the defendant in favor of the plaintiff.
Okay.
There is a very interesting concept in summary suits, which is known as leave to defend. What is leave to defend? Leave to defend is basically the concept that the defendant in summary suits has no right to defend, okay, prima facie. So it may just appear very, one-sided or biased or against principle of natural justice, but this procedure is only because the plaintiff can get faster resolution by the courts.
Okay.
So leave to defend is basically when the defendant, after consideration of the facts, is given time or given opportunity to defend his or her case.
Okay.
And the important element of leave to defend is the substantial reason or presence of any kind of facts that can lead to a trial.
Okay.
Okay. I will give you an illustration, very brief illustration. Let's say the plaintiff has suggested filed certain facts through the petition. Now the defendant, if he or she comes back with certain facts, which as per the discretion or judgment of the court suggests that these facts need to go through a particular trial or need to be discussed before the court, and the defendant should be given an opportunity. So as per the discretion of the judge, this leave to defend is granted, and this opportunity is given under Rule 3, Subrule 7 of Order 37.
Got it.
So that is leave to defend and summary suits in brief.
All right. So now that we know the difference between the two types of suit, how can a person decide whether to go for a summary suit or a money suit?
Okay, that's a very interesting question again, Rinoy. So I would suggest if a person has to decide whether he has to choose summary suit or ordinary civil suits, he should first consult an attorney who can advise him on what particular type of suit is more suitable for his case. However, to keep it very frank, summary suits can be filed in a very few matters involving bills of exchange, such as a check or promissory notes, contracts, or any kind of guarantees of specified nature.
Okay.
All right. If there is something of a very written and instrument that records the kind of transaction we have, then in that case you can go to the summary, go for the summary suits. Otherwise, you have to go for an ordinary civil suit. Now, the differentiation in these two types of suits is basically the timeline.
Okay.
Summary suits are enforced under specific timelines, and the ex parte decree, which is basically a decree in the absence of one party, is easily passed compared to ordinary suits, where multiple summons, you know, have to be issued to the defendant and time is granted to the defendant. So we can compare that 10 days in summary suits versus the 30 days in ordinary civil suits. In summary suits, the defendant has no inherent right to defend, but only is allowed if he is granted the leave to defend, compared to ordinary civil suits, where the defendants have the right to defend and are given ample amount of time.
Yeah.
Now, there are two different concepts, such as res sub judice and res judicata. Res sub judice basically mean stay of the suit from any parallel litigation, so as to multiple litigations cannot run involving the same issue and same set of facts. Okay. And in res judicata, which suggests that if a particular issue or matter is already decided by a competent court, the same matter cannot be taken up again by a similar court. So these things are not applicable to summary suits. So in a case, let's say if you have already been given a particular decree by a civil court, then in that case, you can approach another civil court for the summary suit.
All right.
Now, again, and also summary suits, the setting aside of an ex parte is very strict and only is allowed under special circumstances and not just with sufficient cause.
Okay.
That's all we can use to differentiate between summary suits and civil suits.
All right, Antim. So with that, we come to the end of this session. I look forward to connecting with you over the rest of our topics.
Yep.
Until then, thank you. Take care. Bye.
Thank you, Rana. Thanks.
All right.
Get 300 plus services. Chat and email with our team directly. Get stunning discounts and rewards. Only on Vakil Search app. Download now.